So good evening, everybody. Okay. First, I have to start with the coming out. I have only recently started to think about men and masculinity, so my contribution will be a very, very simple and I hope clear-cut one, with the aim to explore the ways in which media. Horrible start. Let's see. So the ways in which media represent men and masculinity. This contribution actually grounds on a larger research project focusing on media, violence and gender. And looking at a popular culture text. My research goal to the end of this contribution is to to analyze the image of men and masculinity that emerges from media depiction of male violence against women. My assumption is that, is a very simple one, is that media representation of gender violence draw on and at the same time reproduce very precise, though not always rarely explicit, gender role models and models of intimate relations as well. So my research question can be summarized as the following. First one, how is male violence against women portrayed in factual and in fictional media genres? And how do these representations relate to dominant construction of masculinity? As far as my corpus is concerned, I took into consideration first of all, IPV, intimate partner violence. This is my main focus, but I will also refer to other forms of gender violence. And the case studies forming my corpus include TV series, news items covering EPV incidents, and hip-hop lyrics, including either both Italian products and globally circulated media products, so both sides. As said, this stems from a larger research project that I have been carrying out for years now, together with a colleague of mine, Sveva Magaraja, who is also present at this conference. Methodology is discourse analysis. So first research question, how is media male violence against women portrayed in media representations? Now, I have to be very brief on this, but we can see that a precise politics of representation can be found across media, genres, products, and geocultural context. And to the end of this contribution, the most relevant, the most important aspect of this politics of representation is the normalization process that male violence against women undergoes in media representations. Now, this normalization process takes different forms, and the first one is normalization is as naturalization. So, for example, this is something I'm sure everyone has noticed while reading newspapers or listening to TV broadcasts and so forth. EPV news coverage. In EPV news coverage, normally articles or news items in general with female perpetrators differ significantly in the frequency with which potential reasons behind the attack are reported as compared with articles with male perpetrators. This is said about American newspapers, United States newspapers, but in a research carried out on Italian newspaper, we could find that exactly the same thing happened. They tend to to kind of underrepresent the reason why a man murdered his partner or ex-partner, while they tend to overrepresent and insist upon the reason leading to an attack at the hands of a female perpetrator against her man or former man. So the implicit assumption being reproduced here, of course, is that violence acting is a natural behavior for men, while it is not a natural behavior for women. Now, exactly the same discursive construction can be found in fictional text, for example, in movies. And Oliver Stone's Natural Born Killers is a paradigmatic case. Of course, this does not address violence against women only. They are a killer couple. This movie features a killer couple that are supposed to be natural born killers. But no, that's not true. Actually, only the man is a natural born killer, because in the discursive construction of the movie, we can see that Mickey and Mallory Knox, the two, both come from abusive homes, but this backstory functions very differently, because it serves to pathologize Mallory, the human's acting, and mark it as unnatural for her gender, while it serves to establish a continuity between Mickey, the man, and the abusive man and his family, as if violence was the expression of a genetic factor. He says, "I come from violence, it's in my blood, my dad had it, his dad had it." So Mickey, and only Mickey, is a natural-born killer. Many other popular culture products draw upon the same construction. Killer Instinct is a popular TV series. Born to Kill is a true crime TV series recently broadcast, and so on. If we look at the specific of intimate partner violence, well, here, vampire narratives are a very interesting case. You are kind of out of target in terms of age, but if you have children or... No, probably not, because actually all these products were intended to adolescents and teenagers, but actually they built up a cult following among adult, grown up as well. Young adult, they are called, but I mean, the target is not limited to young adult only. Vedi, appunto, ecco. So, for example, the TV series Angel, that is a spin-off from one of the most globally circulated TV series, Buffy the Vampire Slayer, the TV series The Vampire Diaries, the TV series True Blood. Probably they do not, they are not significant to you, but these are very, very important franchise. The Twilight Saga, most of all, including four films and four films based on four novels. All these TV films and TV series and films are based on novels written by women, which is interesting, and all of them portray male vampires who are in love with a human adolescent. Women, human girls. These vampires are particular vampires, as they struggle to quell their violent instinct towards women. So they daily resist the urge to murder or to harm their beloved adolescent girl. And in so doing, they distance themselves from bad vampires who, on the contrary, do not resist these urges and harm humans, still feed on human being. So these are morally reformed vampires, as they were labeled. And their representation is in line, in my opinion, with the classical heroes of Western culture who are portrayed as a specialist in violence, but at the same time exalted for their refusal to use violence. So, research question number two, which are the implications in terms of masculinity construction deriving from this representation of violence as normal and normal insofar as natural? Well, first of all, as you have noticed, of course, naturalization here takes the specific form of essentialization, basically. And I realize that it is difficult to describe this idea or at least to include all the media product that use this discursive construction, but I can tell you is pervasive. It's impressive the number of texts, both fictional and factual, that reproduce this idea of violence being inherent to male. Popular culture texts describe the notion that boys are inherently violent and that urge to harm women are endemic to masculinity. This is the concept being reproduced over and over again. And as a second consequence, masculinity is constructed in binary terms, defined in terms of a dualism wherein good boys repudiate their own instinctive, because they are instinctive, predilection for violence, and bad boys allow it to go unchecked. Second form of this normalization process, male violence turns out to be, appears to be, a justifiable byproduct of heterosexual relationships. Vampire narrative, to go back to these very successful narrations, violence is presented as the risk that these teenage girls have to take if they want to fulfill their love dream with their male vampires. This is the same. The same happens in the factual realm, for example, in the representation of femicide in factual entertainment. And I studied the case of this very popular docufiction called Amore Criminale, Criminal Love. And I made a comparison with the representation of femicide in news coverage, in Italian news coverage. And I could find that the same construction is kind of used, wherein male violence is made to appear as an illness affecting intimate relations, and femicide is a life incident, is something that just can occur in intimate relations, so that both perpetrator and victim actually end up by being victims of this ill love. Just a short example taken from Italian newspaper coverage of femicide. Fabiana Luzzi was a 16 years old girl. She was burned alive by her ex-partner. And her femicide was represented as the outcome of one argument like many others. This is Il Sole 24 Ore, a very important financial newspaper in Italy. Like many other in their relationship that was characterized by highs and lows. Now, the highs and lows construction is one of the most recurring one across media genres and countries. Just an example, the idea of love relation as an alternation of extreme feelings, of high and lows, and of the violent conflict being the natural outcome of this alternation is magnified, amplified in popular music, A paradigmatic example is represented by this song, Love the Way You Lie, 2010, sung by Eminem and Rihanna. And here there is a metatextual kind of interplay, because they are pop icons for sure, but they also are symbols of EPV that he, Eminem, acted against his former wife, and that Rihanna had to endure at the hands of her former boyfriend, rapper Chris Brown. These are very, very overrepresented incidents. They sing, when it's going good, it's going great, but when it's bad, it's awful. So love relation is represented as this alternation of extreme feeling. And the one who sings this is he, Eminem, who at the same time is threatening to burn alive his girlfriend, played by Rihanna, and he says, I will set the house on fire, I will tie you to the bed and set the house on fire if you leave again. So, complexively, all these media products basically reproduce one of the most recurring IPV myth, according to which much of what is referred to as intimate partner violence actually is a normal reaction to relationship conflict, so normalization in these terms. But, and this is my last part, violence against women is normalized, is not only normalized, is more frequently, I would say, celebrated as the measure of a man's love, as an index of the degree of passion and affection of a man towards his woman. Love the Way You Lie, again, Eminem, after deciding, after giving up, setting the house on fire, says, maybe it's not crazy, maybe that's what happens, violence, that's what happens when a tornado meets a volcano. And this mythopoiesis of violence, of course, is reinforced by the video clip images showing the two of them having sex in very erotic scenes where violence and passion are, of course, intertwined. Mixed up. In femicide news coverage, again, romantic love frame is the most recurring one, both in Italian coverage and in the US and in the UK. In other countries as well, but these are the last results I could I can show you. This romantic frame, romantic love frame, is made up by several elements. For example, empathetic attitudes towards the author of EPV. So for example, in Italy, taken from an Italian newspaper, he could not stand the idea that Christina had fallen in love with another man, so he killed her in front of their 2 years old. This is just an example of a multitude of expression that carry on the idea that express empathetic attitudes towards the and justify the author. But of course, this romantic love frame is epitomized at best by headlines such as "He murdered her out of jealousy." Now, jealousy, of course, is positively connoted in our culture, not only because it is a passion and every passion is kind of positively connoted, but more specifically because jealousy is read by newspapers. I mean, I'm referring to the ways in which jealousy is made to appear in the discursive universe of Italian newspapers. Jealousy is read as a sign of attachment and of true love, exactly as in romance novel studied by Janice Redway. But jealousy is also the manifestation of a man's natural instinct to protect his couple and therefore the whole species. So jealousy in the end is perceived as a healthy passion. The demonstration is that when journalists intend to stigmatize jealousy and to mark it as excessive, they say he was affected by excessive or obsessive or morbid jealousy, as if, I mean, implying that a normal, regular, acceptable level of jealousy exists. Just because jealousy is seen as the sign of attachment. No, it's just the sign of one's man's ego, not of his love towards his woman. Now, my conclusion. Implication in terms of masculinity construction, implication stemming from this normalization process of violence, wherein male violence against women is even celebrated as a regular component of heterosexual relations, tolerated as a regular component of heterosexual relations, and sometimes even celebrated as the measure of love. Implication, of course, violence is not something men need to be ashamed of. This representation is consistent with hegemonic masculinity, insofar as violent men are recast in the role of protector of women from, first of all, the bad guys, of course, who would otherwise prey on them, something that is referred to as the chivalry trap, as you know. But we men are recast in the role of a protector of women from themselves as well. So men are legitimized to decide on behalf of an incompetent woman whose promiscuous conduct jeopardizes the couple. This is true for femicide, men who commit femicide, as well as of vampire and so on. Of course, this construction perpetuates sexist gender relations in which women must depend on men for protection, thus depriving them of agency or equality. Not a very clever conclusion, but I'm still thinking on it. So thank you for your attention.